Hey, you. Yeah, you. Hey, all this talk about helping the world's poor escape their poverty, well, you might actually be taking it seriously. And if you are, well, then this video and this book right here, Dance Lest We All Fall Down by Margaret Wilson, they're for you. You see, if you want to help poor people in poor countries, you're going to have to learn how they live. Sounds obvious, I know, but apparently it's not. You see, there are plenty of people working in the international aid industry today who really have absolutely no idea what they're doing. That's because they never thought it necessary to go live among the poor in order to more thoroughly understand what the poor need, what the poor want, what they fear, and generally just how they see the world around them. But you're going to do it better. Eventually, and maybe even soon, you're going to go out and you're going to explore the world of these poor people who you hope to help. And I suspect in doing so, your mind is going to be blown. Your self-identity will suffer crises it's never known. The political and economic theories that you've packed tightly into your brain over the years, they're going to shatter like a million unintelligible pieces, and they'll be replaced by a new understanding of the world that is simultaneously far more accurate to reality and far less conducive to the imagining of simple solutions to the world's problems of poverty, inequality, and injustice. So, this video and this book, and well, mainly the book, are intended to ready you up for that big adventure. And how? Well, by using an old school virtual technology called ethnography to allow you to experience vicariously through the eyes of someone of a similar background to you, the lives of people inside a Brazilian favela, otherwise known as an urban slum in Brazil. Later on, you'll go out and do all of this on your own, but this is at least a way to start. Of course, there are some caveats and disclaimers. First, understanding life in a Brazilian favela won't tell you how the world's poor live everywhere. Poor rural life, for example, is a different beast altogether. But even in urban slums in other parts of the world, while all having some things in common, may actually be quite different from each other. For instance, urban slums in Salvador de Bahia here in Brazil might look similar to those in Cairo, Egypt, but due to distinctive roles of religion and their geopolitical history, they are, culturally and politically speaking, worlds apart. Second, your own experience living among the poor will be different than mine or that of Margaret Wilson, because for starters, your personality and life experience is already unique, but also because the way people treat you will be conditioned by the way you physically look, the color of your skin, the clothes that you wear, your age, the gender you identify with, the gender that other people ascribe to you. Yeah, your experience is going to certainly be your own. And yet, if you're taking this class, you've probably lived most or all your life in what is known by virtually every poor person around the globe as the richest country in the world. Yes, the country whose popular culture has been a singular reference everywhere on Earth for at least a century. The country that is widely believed to control everything, or at least it has the ability to control everything if it so wished. And now that means that no matter what identity you prioritize back home, here in the Brazilian favela, you will be first and foremost and always an Americano, a gringo. And that means a whole lot. Okay, so let's jump right into it. What kind of thing should you expect to see and feel and experience when you move into your Brazilian favela? Number one, expect to feel a bit uncomfortable. First, because it's probably really hot, because this is the tropics after all. And the heat gets a whole lot worse indoors because favela homes are built like a brick oven. They trap the sun's heat, they're built too close together to allow for any circulation of air, and they certainly don't have air conditioners. So yeah, you're going to feel pretty freaking hot. And with all that heat, it's going to smell pretty bad too. You see, you probably have open sewage flowing alongside your house. That's a nasty little gift from your neighbors living uphill from you. And there's trash everywhere too, because there's no system in place to remove it. And trash, as you know, it smells bad. Well, unless you're a rat, and then maybe it smells yummy. Oh, and you're going to feel cramped of space. It's cool if you can rent your own room so you don't have to share a mattress on the kitchen floor with a bunch of other people, like a lot of people do in favelas. But even then, your bed, if you have one, is going to feel too small, and your mattress will be made out of some moldy foam. Or if it had springs, the springs are going to tear up through your back when you try to sleep. And anyways, it's going to be hard to sleep because there's a lot of cockroaches crawling all over the place at night. They fall from the ceilings and Yeah, regardless, you're still not sleeping anyways because there's just too much freaking noise. The evangelical church across the alleyway is blasting its Jesus music all night long to compete with your neighbor's nightly hip-hop jam, which itself is competing with your other neighbor's traditional country music. It's a cacophony of mutually unintelligible beats and melodies that drive your mind to absolute madness. And so you think, why doesn't someone just call the police and shut them up? But alas, you then remember that you're in a favela. If the police ever come around here, it is certainly not to deal with noise complaints. But over time, you grow accustomed to this environment. And as the physical discomforts become less daunting to you, you start to feel yourself undeniably falling in love with other aspects of favela life. Like, take for example, the fact that favela homes tend to feel like tiny little solar ovens also means that you and everyone else around you are always hanging out in the alleyway or on the front stoop where the air is a lot cooler. And everything and everyone is always chatting about this or that. They're always smiling and laughing or dancing to some music blasting on the radio. It's partly because of these things that the favela community feels so very much alive. You feel alive. And you start to forget what it's like to feel lonely. You know, lonely like how you always felt back home in the States, back in your sleepy little suburban neighborhood where you rarely, if ever, saw your next door neighbors at all, much less saw them dancing. You might also fall in love with that edgy informality of life in the favela. Well, at first you might be startled to see electrical posts dangerously knotted up with illegal hookups. You'll soon appreciate the below market cost of electricity, of cable TV, and internet services. It's all pirated. Moreover, you'll probably find it quaint, cute, and highly convenient that nobody around you feels the need or ability to get a business license to run a business, because this means that you can grab some beer, some groceries, or some cheap, tasty food at a dozen or more places all within a minute or two walk from your front door. And of course, you are definitely going to make friends. In general, you're going to find that people are so nice and so generous, and you're genuinely going to like almost everyone. But there will be one person among that mass of nice people who will become your best friend. And this person, she'll take you in, show you around, explain how everything works in this strange new world of yours. They'll serve as the primary contact to meet other important figures in your community. They'll act as a shield to protect you against anyone who might want to take advantage of your ignorance. And they'll explain to your neighbors why you, an outsider from the first world, are choosing to live in a developing world slum. And they'll do so in a language that the people around you will understand. So that consequently, your neighbors will actually accept you, not necessarily as one of them per se, but as a welcome visitor to their community, and that's something special. This new friendship will feel very deep and very special because it is continuously sealed and strengthened by the trust-enhancing experiences you share with that person while struggling to deal with the discomforts of living in a world so totally alien to you. In such a world where you constantly feel anxiety, this person helps connect you back to your old confident self. And you love them for that. Now, you might wonder sometimes why this person actually likes you. You might speculate that the reasons are, in part, kind of superficial. Like maybe your friendship brings them a special kind of social status in their community. Like maybe you make them feel like they're more than just a slum dweller, more than a mere favelado, as we would say in Brazil. Being your friend, maybe you can make them feel like a global citizen, a true cosmopolitan, someone who can't be reduced to a passive and hapless victim of their own country's colonial past. And yeah, undoubtedly, these superficial things may be a part of your friendship. And yet, you know in your heart that the friendship goes much deeper than that. It is real. It is very real. And it's especially beautiful to you because you know that it is the kind of friendship that builds bridges between worlds. The kind of friendship the world really needs if we're ever going to bring real equity, justice, and universal knowledge to the human experience. More on that friendship in just a minute. For now, after you've been living in the favela for a few months, you'll start to notice that people in poor communities tend to be chock full of behaviors that seem pathological to positive and sustained development. And this will start to bother you a bit. You'll still admit readily that poor people themselves may be as rational as anyone else, of course, but you'll start to feel that their rationality is perhaps a bit more bounded, perhaps limited by a lack of education and by economic stresses that compel them to prioritize immediate survival and status needs over long-term growth and improvement. You'll see that your neighbors are doing things that you really don't think they should do. Maybe Dona Angela took out a high-interest loan from an illegal lender just so she could pay for her kid's birthday party. That's a luxury she can't afford, right? Maybe you realize that Dona Lingiani is nudging her 13-year-old daughter into a life of prostitution. Not cool, Lingiani. The Souza family, meanwhile, they refuse to put their kids in school and instead send them out to sell candy to tourists on the beach. The point is, eventually, you're going to start pulling your hair out because the poor aren't behaving like you think they should if they really wanted to escape their poverty. However, you also start to forgive your neighbor for their pathologies. For you will notice that physically as well as psychologically, many people around you have suffered what we in the global north would immediately identify as serious traumas. In the poorest parts of Favela, for example, you'll notice that there are lots of people with missing limbs. And you'll realize that, you know, after talking to them a bit, that if they hadn't grown up poor, well, they never would have lost those limbs in the first place. And the psychological traumas, of course, are much more common still. A particularly common trauma coming from domestic violence, which is usually perpetrated by an alcoholic father who may beat his wife and children, or perhaps just abandon them altogether. You also hear rampant humors of little girls and boys being sexually abused in their homes. And after putting two and two together, now you start to understand why you've vaguely noticed, but haven't been able to put your finger on, this point that the clear majority of households around you are headed by single mothers. Mothers who have to work two or even three full-time jobs just to make ends meet, while their kids are left to tend for themselves. And you ask yourself, where are all the dads? After 6 months in the favela, you're going to start seriously reflecting on things. You're no longer so afraid or so physically uncomfortable as you were when you first came, but you're also not feeling that same exhilaration as before. The novelty, it's worn off a bit. Now you're starting to feel spiritually drained. You once thought being poor was about not having money. Now you realize that money is only part of the problem. Poverty, you know now, is a whole constellation of shortcomings, both material and mental, both financial and attitudinal, that cut away at the foundation of a person's personal dignity, of one's sense of self-worth. Now you're tired and almost angry at your neighbors for not doing more to educate themselves, for not demanding more from their government, for voting yet another corrupt politician into office, all for the price of a free local concert or some concrete, knowing full well that he'll do nothing for the community in the future. You grow annoyed that they just seem to sit there on their haunches all day in this fatalistic way, never expect that anything could possibly be different, that things could get better. And if you're going to be honest, you're also starting to feel a bit traumatized yourself. You've seen some terrible things after all. Once you had to walk under a dangling, charred black body of a man who electrocuted himself while trying to hook up his home to the electrical grid. On several occasions, you saw a local shop owner beating his wife in the plain of day with blunt objects, right out there in the open and with no consequence. But the worst thing of all was that dried up little puddle of blood where little Neto used to sit, that 12-year-old boy who would always smile and say, "Good morning, gringo," oiling his revolver as he walked by. You somehow led yourself to believe that it would never happen to him. And so, as things go, you decide that, okay, you've learned enough, and now you can move out of the favela. After all, there's a lot more to Brazil than just poverty and favelas, and you deserve to experience those other nicer things too. And so you go online and you find some European exchange students who are looking to share their rent on a nice beachside apartment, and you find that, oh wow, they're so excited to bring you out and into the deal. So I take up the deal, and abruptly and dramatically, your whole world changes. Now in your new apartment, it feels like ages since you've had privacy, space, peace, and quiet. You and your roommates lie in hammocks on the balcony, and you drink caipirinhas as the Atlantic breeze keeps you cool and relaxed. Everything is beautiful. Everyone is thin, good-looking. Everyone has a full, straight set of teeth, few, if any, visible scars, and no missing limbs. They all look like they could be magazine models. In any case, you really think that your new friends and this new beachside apartment is fantastic, and so you want to show it off to your best friend from the favela. Let's call him Andre. And so to this end, you decide you're going to organize a barbecue with your roommates, and you invite Andre and his family over. Meanwhile, your roommates invite their own friends, and their friends are mostly these upper middle class students that they met at the university. Everyone decides they're going to chip in and buy a bunch of grade A meat and some ice cold beer, and now you're all set. It's going to be a kick-ass party. But then, after everyone has shown up, you suddenly get a sinking feeling. Your roommate and his rich friends, and their rich friends, are having a blast. They're drinking, they're smoking, they're talking about their recent trips to Miami and London. But Andre and his family, they've somehow squeezed themselves into the darkest, most invisible corner of the apartment, and they haven't spoken a word since they've arrived. They haven't even touched their plates or their drinks. Moreover, they look to you almost like they've physically transformed. Their skin now looks darker. Their bodies have shrunk. They look like miniature painted statues of their former selves. And you can tell they are miserable. And you can also tell that there is some confusion among your roommate and their friends. For they're used to being served by these people who look like Andre and his family, not sharing a social environment as equal. How are they supposed to interact with these reticent and awkward class intruders? It seems that they had no idea, and so the two groups of friends, yours and those of your European roommates, don't interact at all. You're still drawn to the laughter and cheer of the rich folks, because that's obviously where the life of the party is, but you feel too torn to really enjoy yourself. And now you're starting to feel angry at Andre and his family. Why can't they just lighten up and enjoy themselves? Secretly, you can't wait for them to just leave on their own accord so that you can stop feeling terrible inside. And well, soon, very early on in the evening, they do just that. Andre comes up with some stupid excuse that you both know is a lie, but you don't argue with him. And that's it. He and his family are gone, out the door. Over the coming months, you still keep in touch with him, and even you visit him in the favela every time, from time to time. But nothing is the same as it was before. Before your chic barbecue party. It was as if a great illusion was shattered that night, an illusion of social equality that served as the foundation of your friendship, a foundation that seemed solid as a rock while you lived alongside the poor in their community, but which turned into sand and started to collapse as soon as you left. And so you begin to understand the deeper significance of that immense power disparity that separates the rich from the poor, the haves from the have-nots. And no matter what social class you identified with back in your own country, here in Brazil, you are one of the rich. Here, you are among the haves. You have power, and you have lots of it. And with that power, you can do pretty much anything at all. Anything except give that power up. Or can you? You tell me. I'm Professor Michael Wolf, and this is the Politics of Development Online. I fly like paper, get high like planes. If you catch me at the border, I got visas in my name. If you come around, hey, I'll make a more day.